A common question on my video about the effectiveness of Molotov cocktails against tanks was the question if Molotov cocktails could set off the explosive reactive armor on tanks. Additionally, the question is why there are burnt out tanks that have explosive reactive armor blocks that were not set off, and similarly, why this is the case with blown off turrets as well. First off, explosive reactive armor are these little boxes and sometimes other shapes on tanks. What do? They are intended to defeat hollow or shaped charge warheads like the Panzerfaust, but also more modern anti-tank guided missiles. There are also anti-tank gun rounds that use this principle. They are generally called heat shells for high explosive anti-tank. A hollow charge explodes in such a way that the direct explosion with the liner creates a jet that penetrates armor. The details are important here, I once got this wrong myself. Remarkably, contrary to popular myth, the material that forms the jet is not molten, but rather a stretching plastically deforming rod. It is usually referred to as a jet mainly because it is assumed that it behaves like a fluid in the models used to simulate its behavior. Explosive reactive armor in a way follows the principle of fight fire with fire. Much in the same way that the formation of a shaped charge jet is simple and elegant, its defeat by explosive reactive armor is also simple and elegant, discovered by Manfred Held back in the early 1970s. The simplest construction of explosive reactive armor consists of two steel blades sandwiching a layer of high explosive. Here you can see a simple example on how the steel high explosive sandwich is set up. A while ago I saw photos of burnt out Russian tanks and I was baffled at first that although the track wheels and other stuff was deformed and looked like it had melted or bent due to the heat from the fire combined with the weight of the tank. Meanwhile, the explosive sandwiches seemed all fine. I also had at one point briefly read that some Russian tanks had the explosive missing from the explosive reactive armor. But I was cautious, so I dropped tech error a line and he noted that reactive armor generally is designed so that it is not easily set off. Which makes a lot of sense, since if you have a lot of them next to each other, one shot could create a chain effect or set the explosive dominoes rolling and the whole protective setup would be rather ineffective. So I thought I would dig deeper. Since it's called explosive reactive armor, let us start with explosives. The choice of explosive, which is sandwiched between the two metal plates, is obviously most important, as it must detonate when struck by a shaped charge jet, but not when an explosive arrow pack is struck by bullets or shell fragments. It should also not detonate due to a fire or field repairs involving welding. Detonation must also be confined to the model struck by a jet, and not allowed to spread by sympathetic initiation to adjoining modules. Otherwise, a single shaped charge hit would strip a tank of all its explosive reactive armor, instead of depleting only one module. In that regard, little has changed. The professor of impact dynamics Paul Hazell notes in his book about armor the following, which includes a bit more information. Modern explosive reactive armor packages also must provide sufficient protection against small arms ammunition, and the explosive employed must be sufficiently insensitive so that it is not detonated by fragments. Protection against heat sources such as that provided by exposure to napalm is also desirable. He further adds the following. Many countries, such as the United Kingdom, are only prepared to adopt insensitive munition-compliant products in service. Explosives that are very difficult to accidentally initiate are almost universally cast polymer bonded explosives, PBX based materials. These materials are very difficult, if not impossible, to initiate unless a very violent stimulant such as a shaped charge jet penetrates them. Although be aware that napalm probably could degrade certain types of reactive armor. Keep in mind it should not explode, but potentially the heat from napalm might be enough to burn them and or expand them enough that the metal containers eventually would break open. Tankolard notes about Soviet Kontakt 1. This essentially means that large areas of the tank may become unprotected after it is doused in burning napalm. Of course, now the question is, if explosive reactive armor is almost as insensitive as a brick, which it often at least resembles from the shape, how does it set off when it should do so? Some fancy computers, sensors, well, actually due to the nature of fighting fire with fire, this problem apparently solves itself, according to Hazell. Due to the very high pressure region incurred in the explosive composition by the jet, it is relatively simple to guarantee initiation when desired, whilst at the same time remaining safe at all other times. So if explosive reactive armor works as generally designed, a fire from a Molotov cocktail should not be able to set it off. Similarly, the tank slowly burning out neither. This is also stated by Tankolad about first generation Soviet Kontakt-1 explosive reactive armor. Kontakt-1 is safe enough from external damage that destroyed tanks clad in Kontakt-1 are universally observed to retain their Kontakt-1 blocks, even if the metal of the tank itself is completely burnt out from a catastrophic destruction. This shows that the blocks do not detonate even when burned by the intense heat of ammunition or fuel fires for prolonged periods. Yet this brings us to the next question: why is Kontakt-1 and others not set off when a tank violently explodes? Well, I assume this comes down to the simple fact that during such an explosion the reactive armor sandwiches are on the opposite side of the explosion, which is behind the main armor of the tank. So they are rather well protected. Due to this, all pressure is released somewhere else. Namely, all the energy from the explosion goes out by the hatches, or if the turret pops, by the turret ring. Since explosions go the way of the least resistance and the reactive armor block sits on the other side of the most resistance. Yet there's a minor problem now. Since some of you might know that some explosive reactive armor, like originally Soviet now used in Russia Kontakt-5 armor. Kontakt-5 also protect against armor piercing fin stabilized discarding sabot projectiles as well. As such, it's also called universal reactive armor. This is called universal reactive armor, since it degrades the performance of both APFSDS and heat warheads in contrast with first generation of Kontakt reactive armor, which degraded only heat warheads. This required the use of a steel plate 4 to 10 times heavier than used in the first generation Kontakt in order to interfere with the APFSDS projectile. This of course required a setup that the armor piercing fin stabilized discarding sabot, which is basically a large metal arrow, still sets off the explosive module. Zaloga notes that this was achieved the following way. Kontakt-5 relied on a much more substantial steel plate on the outside of the panel, and this material was sufficient both to increase the degradation of shaped charge jet and also degrade APFSDS penetration by about 20 to 35%. This plate required a more energetic explosive insert with a TNT equivalent of 0.28 kg in the 4S20 panels of the Kontakt-1 versus 0.34 kg in the 4S22 panels of Kontakt-5. The Kontakt-5 panels had to be properly angled for maximum effect, and in combination with their size and weight, they could not be bolted on, as had been the case with Kontakt-1. Kontakt-5 had to be incorporated as a comprehensible designed armor package that would have to be undertaken during original manufacture or during capital rebuilding. Similarly, Hazell notes, mostly APFSDS defeating explosive reactive armor consists of heavier and harder plates and larger volumes of high explosives. Probably the most famous example is Kontakt-5 that had been deployed on the T-80Us and T-90s. Some reports suggest that it adds 300 mm of equivalent rolled homogeneous steel armor protection against APFSDS by the propulsion of a 15 mm thick front flyer plate. However, thicker plates mean that you have to use thicker explosive layers. Be aware that according to the German tank engineer Rolf Hilmes and others, there are currently four different generations of Soviet or now Russian explosive armors. First generation is Kontakt-1, second generation is Kontakt-5, third generation is Relict, and fourth generation is Malachit. And it seems that at least for Kontakt-1 armor, the chances of chain reaction and or setting off multiple armor blocks at once is possible. The detonation of Kontakt-1 block generally has little effect on the neighboring blocks due to the sufficient sturdiness of the 3 mm sheet steel boxes. This completely prevents chain detonations. However, the sheet steel boxes are generally not enough to resist the blast pressure of a large explosive warhead, especially if there is a strong fragmentation effect. As such, even though an impacting heat missile or grenade can only detonate the Kontakt-1 blocks that intersect with the trajectory of the shaped charge jet, the explosion can strip off multiple blocks from the surface of a tank. As mentioned, Kontakt 5 uses more sensitive high explosives but is protected by stronger steel plates. As such, I suspect that Kontakt 5 might be less prone to such chain reactions, but I could be wrong here. It seems that both Kontakt 1 and Kontakt 5 armor is used on the Russian tanks currently in war in Ukraine. Although finally it should be added, it could also be that the explosive element might be missing as well, but generally a burnout tank that visually seems to have intact explosive reactive armor bricks is not an indicator for missing explosives. To summarize, general explosive reactive armor is designed in such a way that it can't be easily set off. After all, you don't want a machine gun burst or hand grenade that can strip your tank of its defense. This is achieved by the use of rather insensitive high explosives that are at the same time set off by the force of a hollow charge jet. This generally also helps against chain reactions as well, if a block is set off as intended. Although we generally assume that fire sets of explosives, this is generally not the case with some explosives. For instance, C4 plastic explosive can't be set off by burning. I hope you learned something new. Thank you to Andrew for reviewing the script. Thank you to Tankolard for clarifying information on napalm versus Kontakt 1. Special thanks to all my supporters for making trips to museums and to military archives possible. As always, sources are listed in the description. Thank you for watching and see you next time.